say, dude, I feel like everybody's right and everybody's wrong.
100%. Why is this important? Why are we even going here? He's helped a lot of guys. He's also not had success with a lot of guys.
Come in with a purpose, and they're very intentional with what they do and how they do it.
From the majors to the sandlot, baseball and softball share space in one place. Welcome to the farm system.
Fellas, and the ladies, welcome back to another episode of the farm. It is the farm. Hold on, I almost messed that up. And we're sitting down today with our own Riley Valentine, the keeper of the worm, some might call her. Riley, tell the people what's up. Say hello.
Hey, how is everybody?
She's so quiet. Okay, so some of the things we definitely wanted to get into today. I loved one of the conversations that we kind of talked about is I asked you towards the end of the year, and I really wanted to start with this and kind of dive into some of these things is, if you guys don't know, first off is, Riley plays, Alabama. She first was at Texas A&M, first committed to ASU. ASU staff went to Texas A&M. Then when, was 1 year at A&M and then transferred over to Bama, catcher, part-time utility, you know, we'll see where she plays next year. Keeper of the worm, as we said. Also, hold on. Let's go through all the things. Yeah. The worm, go through all your guys' rally time stuff.
Yeah, so we got the rally worm, which is like the pride and joy. The palm tree, which is named Rally Valentine.
Oh, okay.
We've got Gerald, a rubber chicken. Flabby, a rubber chicken.
Okay.
We've got a whole music set. Piano,
wow.
Guitar, drums,
okay,
microphones.
Wow, I saw the microphones.
Water guns.
Mm.
We had a plastic swimming pool. didn't make the cut.
Got it.
But yeah,
you guys almost got like a whole zoo.
A monkey. We have a monkey.
There it is.
Yeah, he's the new guy. Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah. Little Al is his name.
Okay, and you're the keeper. You know all of these things. I heard that they're a little birdie told me that they're in your locker at the moment.
Yes.
Yeah,
they are currently in my locker.
Yep. Got it.
Yep.
Got it. So the one of the things too, obviously you guys ended up having a pretty good run last year, making all the way to the World Series. Boys out there for that. But one of the things I asked you, I don't know, maybe I think you were like in regionals or super regionals at the time or something like that. And I asked you, I was like, hey, because it's funny because the same question ended up coming up when you did your, typically, if you guys don't know, typically how college sports go is, you'll have like an exit meeting at the end of every single year. You sit down with your coach, you recap, you know, the year that you guys go over certain questions. Everybody has their own questions that they ask. But this kind of came up during that interview or exit interview that you guys did going out to the year. And then also I had asked you this towards the end of the year because I kind of do also not only exit interviews, kind of like how the year went, but we usually sit down and recap, you know, going into the off season, like what we want to work on. But one of the things I asked you and also too, I think it was Murph that asked you or Adam asked you at the time, which was, you know, what was like kind of your biggest takeaway from, you know, training with us. And I asked you the kind of the same thing, like, hey, this year, what would you say is like the biggest thing, like the number one thing that you learned? And then a typical Riley fashion, her first thing was, oh my God, so much. She'll say some big broad thing and I'll have to get her down to, okay, yes, let's isolate what, you know, what that means. Why don't you kind of start with, what answer you gave when they asked you and then also when I asked you and let's start talking about that.
Yeah. I think like, obviously I learned so much about my body that like things that I didn't even know before and like how important like so many little things are that you just don't even think about as a hitter, which is like obviously super important. But I think the biggest thing for me was like obviously I have the tools to play at that level, and so I think just like trusting those and like I like we talked about just like learning how to be a hitter, like we talked about like having an A swing, great, perfecting your A swing, but then like finding a way, like playing 14 innings against Tennessee, like I'm not trying to get my, like I'm trying to put a ball in play and get on base. And so like just learning how to be a hitter mentally, physically, like I was tired, regional, super regionals, World Series, like my body is fatigued. And so I'm not going to be moving great, but just being a hitter and finding a way to get the job done at the end of the day for my team, whether it's a drag bunt, a slap and run, hit and run, like anything at that point. And so I think with that being my own coach in a way, and learning how to like feel myself fall back into old patterns or old habits, and even like mentally being my own coach and like being able to feel myself like fall back into either, whether it's like self-doubt or I'm not good enough for this, or like, man, like playing on the World Series, like there's a lot, like, but just being able to like center myself again mentally, and then also like being more aware of my body and how my body's moving, and just being able to coach myself back to like center.
Yeah, no, and I think that's the big piece too. One of the things, you know, because a lot of times, you know, again, we post, I would tell you all the time, great, we're in here and we post all these things of us working on the swing, all these other things. And there's obviously a lot of conversations that happen in there. And obviously a lot of people that are going to be listening to the pod, like they've never trained with us or had that opportunity. But then also, I used to tell you all the time is, and a lot of, and you've even been there when I'm talking to other hitters or, you know, talking through the things as well. And a lot of times those conversations, like it's, you guys just played a doubleheader or whatever, right? It, you know, played a 3-game series. And, you know, again, those conversations of what that looks like after, you know, it's 10 o'clock at night and we're on the phone or, you know, whatever. And, you know, it's common that on the same side of that with our, a lot of hitters, we're having a lot of those conversations because there's a lot more that goes into hitting than just how you're moving. Now, it doesn't mean that how you're moving isn't important, because it's really important, right? And a lot of times, again, it actually has a lot to do with like how we're going to design your approach based off of, you know, we'd be talking to, like, you know, for example, like I bring her up just because like she was really good, but like the same thing too is like, you know, Pickens or somebody like that, right? Is that we know when we're game planning against those hitters, those pitchers, you got to know how you move, what you can hit, right? And then also what, how they're going to approach you and like how they're going to throw to you. And then we would design, you know, approaches and things like that off of that. One of the things I wanted you to kind of like talk through as well is, I think one thing that a lot of people assume when they're just watching sports and athletes, period, and they know it when they're playing it, but they also, even if you ever played before, sometimes I catch myself doing it when I'm watching sports, is I always assume that everybody on the TV screen is 100% healthy all the time, right? And what I mean by that is everybody has these little injuries. I got hit by a pitch 3 weeks ago. I got hit in the ankle. I slid into a bag and someone stepped on me, and like, you know, all these things. And I hear, you know, with all you guys, like I know plenty of players that had like someone step on their hand, or, you know, again, like sometimes it's like first week of the season or like other things, right? And so a lot of times a lot of people like fans watching, they just assume that you guys are always 100% healthy. But meanwhile, I know that, like, obviously with you having such close relationships, not only with all your player, your teammates, but just playing softball for so many years, I was gonna have you like kind of open that up of like, again, that, like you said, like sometimes you're tired, sometimes you're, you know, whatever, and just like what that kind of looks like for you, and like how you kind of go about doing those things like throughout an entire season rather than just like a single day when and I guess let me ask this first question before we get into that. How many days would you say that you felt 100% recovered, ready to go? Like I feel 100% fresh.
Probably zero. I mean, like, yeah. There's days I feel good. There's days I feel like awful. There's days I squatted heavy the day before and now I can't feel my legs. And then there's days that we did bench and now my arms are sore. Like there's always something, but like it comes with the territory of being an athlete. Like I've never felt like 100%, I feel like, in years. Like there's always like my back's tight, my hamstrings are tight, like there's just something. And so I just like, I think like recovery is obviously super important, and they take that super seriously at Alabama. Whether it's like, obviously sleep is super important, but making us cold tub, making us cryo, like we do, like I swim recover and we'll swim laps and I'll do different strokes and all kinds of stuff.
Dry needling. I know you guys do. You guys do a bunch of stuff. And then what are the things called again? I forgot that, like go around your guys' legs and stuff or your arms. What's the,
we have the Normatec boots.
Yeah.
So like, and for example, like when we go on the road, like we're in Oklahoma City for the World Series for 10, like 9 or 10 days. And so like we get a whole hotel room that's just for recovery. And so like we have massage tables set up in there. Like I get a massage once a week and I go in for 30 minutes or an hour. And she's like, hey, what's bothering you, like what's tight, what's this, and we'll get it done. And so that I think is the biggest thing, just taking care of your body, what you put into your body, how you obviously sleep. But then the other side of it is like, yes, I'm an athlete, but I'm a student athlete too. So it's like, yes, recovery and sleep is also super important, but I think being able to like manage all of that, like, okay, great. Like my body feels fine, whatever. But now I've got an exam to study for. So it's also, I think it comes with like a huge balance to where, okay, like, yeah, my body is tired, I'm tired, but like, okay, now I got this to do. Okay, school's great, body's great, I'm out of school, now like my body's my response. Like there's just so many different things, and I just think it comes down to, honestly, like recovery, just taking care of your body, because it's gotta be able to kind of withstand a lot.
Yeah, no, and then I think that's the other thing too, as well, is like, you know, kind of what you were touching on there, is you have like the psychological stuff, right? Where you have a lot of other stressors other than you're a human, right? I know that when you talk specifically about MIRTH, like what's this, like it's like person first, you know, like person, you know,
person
student.
Person before athlete.
Yeah, person before athlete, right? And so like the same thing too as well, like another thing is everybody fans or, you know, people will be watching and they're assuming that, okay, let's say your body is, you're doing all of those things, right? Where other, let's say like other schools, you know, again, for like SEC wise, right? You guys have a lot of privileges and get a lot of things that other schools you don't have access to yet. But also too, a lot of schools have access to things that years ago that no one else had access to, right? So like everything's evolving, right? It all kind of comes with it, right? And then also too, right? There's other sports that might have more access to more things or other things, right? And so that all, you know, it all evolves. Like I used to give you a hard time all the time. I'm like, yo, I play baseball. I played at much smaller schools. I did not have like any of the things that you guys, you know, definitely get to play with. And so I was just thinking about that as well, as just like how, you know, again, how much you guys have all those recovery things and you're still not 100%.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
A younger girl or some, I think there's this like fallacy, right? Like everybody was always like, man, if I could just, you know, I need to recover. And I do all these other things. Like you're never going to feel out 100%, right? As soon as the season starts, right? Again, you're doing everything you can to recover as much as you can.
Yeah.
But a lot of the times too, I think it's the opposite way, and where the mentality that we used to talk a ton and we did throughout the season is so much about mentality, right? Which is like, okay, let's say I'm at 80% today, 75, 60, 40, 20%, right? Maybe I'm just, there's a lot of things that are going, like, you know, again, like the stress from school, you know, again, like spiritually, I'm not doing well. I'm physically tired. You know, there's all of these things, right? I'm having these problems with, you know, my friendships or relationships or, you know, all these other things are all happening at the same time. But one thing that we mess up with that with, let's say we're at 40% or something, right? Is often when I'm at 40%, I'll only show up with 30%. Right? Because I'm not willing to commit all of my 40, right? Like, and so we used to talk about that a lot too. It's just like, hey, if you got 40 today, you like give all of your 40, right? Whatever you got, like you give that day, right? Whatever you know, again, today might not be your day that you feel like your swing feels amazing, but there's no reason for you not to give everything you do have, right? Don't give up all the things you are capable of just because it doesn't feel, you don't feel good.
Yeah.
You know,
that was big for us going into the World Series. Just like talking as a team, was like, obviously everybody's tired. Everybody's got injuries. Like we had multiple girls have multiple surgeries throughout the season. And so it was, okay, if you've got 80%, give 100% of your 80%. If you've got 40, give 100% of your 40. And if everybody can give 100% of what they have, whether in whatever capacity that is, whether it's you're the starting pitcher, you're the starting center fielder, whether you're like keeping charts or like warming up the left fielder, like anything, like give 100% of whatever percentage you have. And Murph was like just big into that too. And obviously his version of it is falls back to the whole Moody to peace, right? Like,
Before we just run past that, yes. I know a lot of people, like, it's so common for you guys. I've brought it up multiple times in conversations where I'm like, yeah, it, you know, he's big on Mudita. And they're like, what is Mudita? I think even Taylor, yeah. when I first brought it up, was like, what is Mudita?
Yeah.
Obviously, it's very common. Their shirts, yeah. other sports yeah, yeah. give, you know, Murph a lot of stuff about it. Explain what Mudita is and, like, how you guys, you know, how Murph kind of, like, presents it to you
yeah,
guys.
Yeah, so Mudita is... it's vicarious joy in other people's success. And so that's the staple of Alabama softball. It's in our locker room. It's the first thing we see when we, like, come in to the, like, clubhouse every day. It's written everywhere throughout. Murph has a tattoo on his deltoid.
I didn't know that.
Of Mudita. Yeah, funny. His first tattoo.
I love
ever.
How she said deltoid instead of shoulder. That's yeah. like, that's good. That's good.
No. So, yeah, Murph is... the way that he kind of found it is, like, on my recruiting meeting, like, we talked 45 minutes just about the word Mudita. Wow. And it's super important to him, obviously, but, like, he was just, like, searching for a way to, like, get it out of his team. Like, how do I get this out of my team? Like, I can use the word jealousy, envy, all of that stuff, but, like, I need, like, there needs to be something. And so he was, like, reading a book or something, and he like, found this word Mudita. And then he, like, looked it up, and he was like, oh, my God, like, that's the word, like, vicarious joy in someone else's success. And so then he, like, was, like, researching. Maybe there's, like, another word. And he's, like, he's big into, like, there's no other word in the English language that means the same thing. And so for us, that's, like, I think this team, especially Team 28, was, if we didn't have Mudita for each other, there was no way that we made it as far as we did.
Mm-hmm.
But – it's also his thing is, like, the three things: you're loved, you're wanted, and most importantly, you're appreciated.
Say that again slower.
You're loved, you're wanted, and most importantly, you're appreciated. And so every day, like, when we start our team meetings, those are the first things he says to us. And
the fact that you said them so quick is how ingrained they are. And you guys just that's why I made you slow it down, because somebody else was like, what? But for you, it's like, yeah, 100%.
But it's Mudita when somebody hits a walk-off home run, or somebody pinch hits for you and hits a double in the gap and scores a tying run. Like, that's obviously Mudita, but it goes to such a deeper level that you don't even feel until you're a part of something like Alabama softball, which I didn't know that something like that even, like, existed, like, a culture could be like that. And I'll be honest with you, I went to my recruiting meeting. I told this, like, 3 days after being at Alabama practice, two-a-days, weights, all the things. I said, Murph, like, I thought this was a show. Like, I thought you were being fake, and I didn't think that it was actually going to be like this, because, like, these college coaches honestly sometimes have to be salesmen, and they have to, like, it's a business at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And so, like, I've been through a lot of recruiting. I've spoken to a lot of coaches, and I thought it was just another recruiting meeting, right? Like, oh, Mudita, oh, this, like, we're going to love you. Like, his other thing, we're going to love you if you're 0-4 or 4-4. Like, he says it every single day. And so I'm like, yeah, like, this is great and all, but, like, I've heard this before, you know? And so it's until you actually are a part of it, you don't understand what it means, and you don't get to see it like we see it every single day. And it's Mudita, yes, between us girls, but the whole staff. Like, I've never been a part of a program. Like, obviously I was at another Power Five big SEC school, which A&M has a great program, like, had a great year this year. But the culture piece was a culture shock for me, honestly, not only because the relationship that we have as a team, but, like, I've never met our behavioral health lady at A&M. Like, I didn't know, like, our bus driver, even if we're not on the road, he comes to every single one of our games. Like, everybody is so involved, and it's truly, like, Murph has made it into, like, such a family over there. And I think that's what makes the program so special, is the way that he just cares about us more than obviously the athlete. And again, his thing is, the only thing in the facility written in gold is right above, like, our locker room. It says person over athlete. And so he's big into that, and again, ingrains it in our brains every single day. Like, softball is not who you are. Softball is what you do. Like, we'll love you if you're 0-4, 4-4. You're loved, wanted, appreciated. And then his biggest thing with the whole Mudita is, like, you can have vicarious joy for somebody else because they were holding the rally worm. You can have vicarious joy for somebody else because they kept the chart for you, or she hasn't had an at-bat in 6 weeks, but she's been keeping charts. And when we played Tennessee in regular season, she knew exactly how she was going to throw to you because she kept the charts. And so she was like, hey, this is what you should be hunting. This is how she approached you last time. And so there's just so many pieces to the puzzle, and it all, everybody accepts their role, and there's no jealousy. There's no envy. There's no, like, I want what she has. Like, any, like, she's starting because X, Y, and Z. Like, no, it's like, I'm happy for you. We're going to do this as a team because it takes all 22 of us. But like, when we go to super regionals on the World Series, there's, we have to take two buses. Like, there's 150 people traveling with us because there's so many people involved. What make Alabama softball, Alabama softball.
Yeah, no. And I think the big thing is, I told you this too. I have known Murph for a couple years now. But I became a major fan of Murph this year. And largely too, you know, largely to just seeing like how he's treated you guys, you know, and, you know, again, like, and you guys, I know you guys, your story, you know, like, we're very, with all of our players, the same thing too, obviously very personal, and knowing what's going on in a lot of your guys' life, because I always feel like too, like, the better I know you, the better I can coach you, right? Like, if I know what's going on, like, you know, like, I can sit here and we can sit here and talk about your swing and all these other things, but like, if you're emotionally in a whole nother place and your mind is in a whole nother place, you know, all those things, that's going to change and dictate not only my communication with you, but also, you know, things that I need to be mindful of, the grace I might need to have today. Because again, you might've had, you know, again, you might be having an exam week, and, you know, not only are we going to adapt our programming based on like, you know, yo, I only got 2 hours of sleep last night because I was, you know, doing all these other things and we didn't get back till 2 a.m. and then I had to be in class and blah, blah, blah. And all these things, right? So I like really trying to be involved, but also too, you know, as well, like, you guys all have, you know, all, every athlete in this, important to remember, which is like, again, from his foundation of how he looks at things, is just remembering too as well, like, you guys are people. And so because of that, the same thing as well, we're very much so like that, which is, I think, a little bit more common maybe in the private space, because we can spend more time and a little bit more intimate. We can have, you know, years of building relationships and a lot of that stuff. But also specifically, again, like, seeing how, you know, like, he helped and supported you through all the personal challenges and things that, like, you went through this year, and all the conversations, even, you know, coming to me and, like, you know, having those conversations, seeing how we can, he could best support, and he could help, and how we could help, and what we were doing, and like all these things, right, was like, obviously he you know, cared about you guys as just people, you know, and it's not just through words, but like his actions and like, you know, and even too, like you said, right, like, if that's at practice, I know we've talked about it at certain times too, about like at practice, like, maybe if you needed to, you know, come a little later, or if you needed 10 more minutes in the thing to collect yourself, or, you know, some of those things as well. Don't you guys, correct me if I'm wrong, but don't you guys have like a room or something, like, where if you're like really upset or something, like, you can step into, or?
I mean, there's always a spot. Yeah. There's always, you kind of find them.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And I was like, just saying, like, with that, right, where, like, you know, there's a place where, like, in Major League's kind of like that too, right? Where a lot of times, like, they'll go down into the clubhouse real quick and, like, you know, and get back collected, because it is frustrating. Like, again, you guys put your heart and souls and sweat and everything else into it, and your blood, right? Like, into what your guys' craft, right? And so it can be frustrating. And it's plenty of times where everybody sees the number at the end of the year, but what they don't see is that, like, man, like, I started the year hot and then finished it cold, or I started the year really cold and then finished it super hot. Or, you know, again, I started the year cold, got really hot in the middle, and then, you know, it again got cold again towards the end of the year, or it was hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, cold all the way through. Right. And there's all of this roller coaster of performance. I know one thing, and I wanted you to speak on this, 'cause I felt like, for me, coaching note from me, as I felt like one of the areas that you grew the most this year, and I think a lot of that, not only with Murph and like them reinforcing it, but one thing that we talked about a ton this year is like not tying your identity to your performance itself.
Yeah.
And yes, softball is something that you do. It's not who you are. And we can say that.
Yeah.
Right. And we can just do that. Right. But what does that actually, you know, what does that actually look like? And so I wanted you to kind of talk through kind of like how, you were kind of at the beginning of the year and how you identified, and then kind of, you know, what throughout the year, kind of what that process looked like, and like how that progressed for you.
Yeah. I think it's a big part of it is just me as a person. Like, I'm a perfectionist. Like, I want I just want everything to be perfect. I spend hours in the cage. I want it to translate onto the field, and that's not always going to be the case. And sometimes I'm like, I'll fall back into spaces like, I work so hard, I do this, but like, it's not showing on the field. Like, why isn't it showing on the field? And so I think Murph's thing is like, as girls and as female student athletes, you see that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And so one day we have a team meeting every day before practice. We meet in the classroom, and a lot of times Murph has the music blasting. He's got cookies, cupcakes, balloons. Like, every day there's something new. And one day we walked in and he played us this like TED Talk video, and it was about teaching women to be brave, not perfect. And so he kind of took that and ran with it. And it's like you guys realize yes, you're the 1% of athletes, but like, you're female athletes playing at such a high level and like being looked at as like these like celebrities to some people. And so like, you're already doing like something brave, right? As he wants to say, but like, you don't have to be perfect to like impress the fans, impress your family, prove it to this person, prove it to that person. And so from Murph, for me, I think what was kind of big for me was I heard it every day. Like, we're going to love you whether you're 0 for 4 or 4 for 4. We're going to love you 0 for 4, 4 for 4. But it's one thing to say it, but it's another thing to actually feel it. And so a moment I clearly remember was we were in Birmingham playing UAB. And I was 0 for 3 with 3 strikeouts on, like, changeups in the dirt.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the worst hitting day of...
I remember.
...of my career. Yeah, yeah. And so... he pinch hit for me. Thank goodness.
Thank goodness.
It was one of those days. And the girl who pinch hit for me, like, hit a home run. And so I think that was one of the most challenging moments, was to, like, have Mudita for her. Because, like, it's hard. You know, it's really, like, I'm frustrated. I'm 0 for 3. What, 3 strikeouts? I'm not, like, I can't see the ball. Like, I don't know where it is. And then she comes in, hits for me, hits a homer. Great. Like, I'm super happy for her, but I think that was the biggest challenging moment for me. And I remember after that game, Murph had like came up to me. Obviously I'm an emotional person. And so I was a mess, and he was just like, I'm proud of you. And like, I don't care. Like, you struck out 3 times, but I don't care. And so like, once I felt like I finally, like, I felt like I hit rock bottom. But to hear him like actually say that, like, he says it all the time, but to actually like feel it is a whole nother thing. And so I think going in the box with that confidence of like, yeah, like, I can look down the line and know that like, no matter what happened, the at bat, the week, the game, the series before, like, I know Murph believes in me. And that gives you obviously more confidence in yourself. And so I think that was part of it. But I think as the year went on, I wouldn't say like I found, like, I just kept it a game, you know, like, I played a game within a game. Like we talked about, 10 swings, like checking off, like how many times can I get my swing off, playing like almost like tricking myself into like,
yeah,
I'm just like playing a game. Or we talked about like playing a wiffle ball game, like,
yeah,
so many different ways to just like keep it so simple and not let the moment get too big. And so I think once I did that and just like trusted myself, and didn't feel like I had to prove it to people, was the biggest thing. And so I felt like that flips, like, I noticeably saw that like watching film of myself, was when we, like, the Kentucky series, I didn't perform, like, I didn't have the best series, but like, I saw like a total different me just watching film. And I think that's probably when we had one of those conversations, was like, okay, go, it's a wiffle ball game, like, so what? Like, doesn't, you're playing against 10-year-olds in grandma's backyard, like, it doesn't matter. And that's when I noticeably saw a difference, was like, I didn't carry one at bat to the next. I didn't carry my defense to my offense or my offense to my defense. Like, it was just like, okay, that at bat's done, like, I can't change it now, it is what it is. But it was also, I think the biggest thing with that was like, okay, first at bat of the game I struck out. I felt like a year ago, 2 years ago, it would have just snowballed and I would have had 3 strikeouts or 0 for 3 with flyouts, whatever. But I also, I feel like there's been so many times where I started a game with a bad at bat and my next at bat I hit like a single, double, homer, like things like that. But I think it's being able to, yes, move on from the bad, so to say, but also like move on from the good. Like it's a whole new at bat. Like once it's over, it's over. Once you're back in the dugout, like it's over. And I think a thing for me, I used to work with Brian Kane. He lived in Arizona. And so I used to, me and my brother would go to his house and like have meetings with him. But like a thing that I do is like, I won't take my batting gloves off until I'm ready to be done. Like if I need a, like, and they allow us, like what you're saying is there a little spot, like you have your moment, like you go into the bathroom, you get it all out. But like, for me, I'm just like, I'm gonna keep my batting gloves off. And once my batting gloves are like off, like it's gotta be done. And so I think just, that was huge for me, just finding a way to not let it continue to like snowball in a way.
Yeah.
Because I would always catch my, like, I'd catch myself a year ago, 2 years ago. All right, like, can't strike out again. All right, you swung a miss, can't swing a miss again.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that's not a good space to be in.
I remember I asked you at one point, I said, how many times can you swing and miss before you lose confidence?
Yeah.
And you just laugh like that. And I was like, -2. And then, you know, cause again, and what I mean by -2, it's like, yo, I'm watching her warm up and I'm like, oh God, she's throwing this rise ball. Yeah. She's throwing 75. Like you're immediately losing confidence.
Yeah.
Just watching, you know, again, you know, great hitters don't do that. Right. And so I told a hitter the other day, I said, look, like if you want to be great, you can't just move great. You got to think great, you know? And so your mentality and how you go about it, right? Like I need to have a great mentality if I'm going to be a great player. And, you know, again, you could have all the great movements, you can have all those things, and we need to work on those too.
Yeah.
Right. And I think a lot of people try to go one way or another. It's like, oh, dude, you could have a great mentality and suck. Okay. Like you're up there and you have all the confidence and you have all the things, but you move like crap and you're not a great athlete and your, you know, swing's not good. like again, that's also, you're not going to play well. Right. So you need all of those things together. And typically people try to emphasize the thing that they weren't the greatest at.
Yeah.
Right. That's the thing they had to really work at. That's the thing that they latch onto.
Right.
And so like if they didn't move well, but they always had a great mentality, when they had to really focus on their movements, then they're all about movements. Right. But if they had, you know, they had great movements, but they had to really focus on their mentality, then they're all mentality. And a lot of times those become the things they focus on. And I also wanted to, you know, bring this up because I know obviously this is big for you, and also a big part of that process is I knew that obviously, you know, with your faith and also too how that developed obviously throughout the year, and that incorporated as well is like as a team, you guys incorporate so much about like your guys' faith and like going to church with Murph, going all these other things, right? Like that's a big place.
Yeah.
How you guys pray together. Like, you know, there's a lot that goes into a lot of that too. So I was gonna also have you kind of open that up and like what that's like, because I know that's not the same on every single team and you know, what that looks like.
Yeah. It's definitely not like something that's forced.
Yeah.
Like, yes, we'll go to church together, but like, if you want to, like, it's not like a forced thing.
Yeah.
But it's cool because it's not a forced thing. Still, how many people choose to come, you know, like in the fall, it's tough first, like when it comes, obviously like spring and season time, but like, in the fall, like we have a church down the street, super nice, but like their college group, it's like, it's Church of the Highlands and their group is called like One. And so like, we'll all go, we'll sit together. We'll like, to go to church, do our thing there. And it's cool. And again, ties back to like the family of Alabama. Like we're there, baseball's there, track and field is there. Like the husband and wife who kind of run the college program, like he ran track at Bama, she was in a sorority. So like it's such a, like everybody's so close, like they come to our games. But I think as a team, just, again, once we got to the World Series, it was like keeping the faith. And yes, faith in God and all of those things, but like faith in things that you can't see and faith in other people. And so like what Murph talked about, like keep the faith, keep the faith. And he's like, well, like, what does it mean? Like, what does it mean to be faithful? And it's like, well, like you have to be able to believe in something that you may not be able to see or feel or this or that. But again, his also thing with that is like the best is yet to come. So you have to truly believe that the best is yet to come, and have faith in that. And then I think another thing is like, we'll have Bible studies as a team. Like we'll meet in the conference room 30 minutes before the game and we'll have about a quick 20-minute Bible study, 10-minute Bible study.
Yeah.
Obviously praying together before the game. Like Murph prays with us before the game. We pray as like a group. And then like obviously I'll pray individually. down the line. But I think, yeah, I was at A&M. We didn't really have that as a team. So I think it's cool to see that like a good 90% of the team is like, we're all super big into our faith. And it's fun to, I think it brings us also so much closer in that sense of just like, we're so vulnerable in ways with each other when it comes to that stuff. Being able to be open at Bible study and all of that stuff. So,
yeah. Yeah. What would you say too, personally with, I know obviously there's many moments and I'm putting you on the spot, but I know there's many moments throughout this year too, as well, that like you heavily had to lean, like, you know, in your relationship with God, one, you know, your personal life, all those other things too, but also too, like when your performance, when you weren't, you know, performing the way that you wanted to at the level that you, the perfectionist, would like to perform at, of all those things, right? Or again, for example, like I know personally for you, you know, you guys would have a scrimmage or something and, you know, against your guys' pitchers that are some of the top pitchers in all the league and all the things. And then boom, Riley hits a home run during that. And then all of a sudden the lights turn on, game comes on, and then like you're not getting the results that you want, right? And like how you were kind of recentering there and like, you know, leaning into your relationship that way. What would you say is like the biggest areas kind of like you grew in your relationship with God throughout this year?
I think obviously the personal aspect of it, I grew a lot, but I felt myself grow a lot in the athletic side of it too, I guess, so to say. And again, the beginning of season, it was tough. It was hard. Not only personal stuff, but just like softball wise, you know, like I would be one of the best hitters in scrimmages and in practice, and then nothing would translate to the game. And it's like, why am I putting all this undue pressure on myself? Because like God already knows what's going to happen. He's got it planned out. What I do or what I think or what I want doesn't matter at the end of the day. And so I think once I finally accepted that, that's when I was able to kind of flip that around and just be like, all right, like wake up, it's another day. Like what you got for me today, God, like what am I going to do for you today? Mm-hmm. Type thing. And so once I finally was accepting to that, I think that's when that kind of changed my mentality, which then translated to the field. And I also think a big thing for me was I grew in just like being able to express how I feel, whether that be about softball, about my personal life, anything like that. But not only like talking about it, but I think a big thing for me is like writing and journaling and just being able to put my feelings on paper. And I also think another thing is like when I'm able to understand how I'm feeling and catch myself falling into certain feelings, whether it's doubt, whether it's anger, whether it's frustration, being able to catch myself and like even if I'm in the box, like being able to catch myself feeling less confident or that I'm doubting myself. But once I was able to recognize those feelings, but then know how to manage them, I guess, know how to center myself again, which comes from like my relationship with God and accepting his plan. And like, what am I putting pressure on myself for? Like everything that's going to happen is going to happen. And so I think that was huge for me. And I definitely grew a lot in that aspect this year.
Yeah. No, I remember we had a couple key conversations that I think that were big. One of the ones that I was thinking of when you were talking through that is we kind of had a conversation about, hey, like God, when you turn all evil for good, right? Even this too, God, you'll use, right? If I go 0-4, you're still using this for me, right? This isn't against me. This isn't to harm me. This isn't to embarrass me. This isn't, you know, a defining moment of being like all these other things. Like, no, like you're teaching me a lesson here, God. And like, what lesson is that? Is it, you know, again, to not identify with my performance, and also too, like, you know, who can straighten the road that God made crooked? Like we used to talk about like that a lot too. It's just like, you know, again, if God is doing these things, or these things are orchestrating the way that they're playing out, is even if it doesn't go my way, God can use this too, right? And again, the best is yet to come. Another way of saying that, right? The best is yet to come. And it's like, you know, again, there's nothing that isn't for me.
Yeah.
Everything that happens today is for me. Mm-hmm. It's going to benefit me in some way, in some motion. It might not be the way that I'd like. I'd like to go for four homers every time, right? But at the same time, is that really what's best for me,
right?
As a person, is that really what's best for me? Is that what's best for my soul?
Yeah.
All those things. And then I remember too, late in the year too, you're gonna be like, oh yeah, that combo. we had the combo where, actually there's two combos I want to bring up. One combo was when you did go 0-for-3, right? And you called me crying. And you were just like super, super overwhelmed, you know, all those other things. And I was just like, I think the big thing too there, and the reason I think that was big is not only obviously Murph doing those things too, but also when you called me, like we were like that as well. Like I wasn't upset with you, or, you know, a lot of times I think coaches can do that in that moment where like you needed support, you needed perspective, you needed all these other things. You didn't need someone to tell you you suck today when you were 0-for-3. Like you were already doing that to yourself. You get what I'm saying? I think I even made a tweet about it that day. It was like the last thing that I needed to hear when I went 0-for-3 with 3Ks, right, is someone to tell me that I suck today. Like I know I suck today. Like if anything, I need to be encouraged or go into tomorrow, right? And then, and then specifically too, you know, there was a motivational combo. I'm thinking of all these combos we had now had. There's a motivational combo where, you know, I want to call this out because every athlete has this. I have this, and if you haven't had this, you're lying, okay? Everybody has a moment when they're ready to throw in the towel.
Yeah.
Right? This is why we need a team. This is why we need people around us that love and support us, to redirect us, to give a perspective, all those other things, right? Like I have these same exact moments even now as a grown man, like all those other things, right? Like where you're like, yo, like emotionally, like I can't do, like I'm overwhelmed, all these other things. And like you communicated those things. And I was like, I hit you with that other perspective. And I'm funny because I'm thinking about, I was in a moment of super motivation with you, but I was like, I'm not quitting on you. Like, you're not quitting on me. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I'm not quitting on you. Like, you're not quitting on me. You know, like, we're going to ride this thing, you know, to the end, like all these other things. And, you know, we had one of that combo. But also, I know a major one, and this one was towards the end of the year that I knew was a major combo that we had, was a combo that we had about, I was like, you told me straight up, you're like, yo, I feel like I'm letting you down. You know, and that was a major combo that we had. You're like, I feel like I'm letting you down. I feel like I'm, you know, all these other things. And you're putting this pressure on yourself, even from me. And then I had the combo. I'm like, girl, I don't care if you never play softball again. Like, I could care less if you ever play softball. I don't care if you don't play for Bama. I don't care. Like, all these things. Like, you never need to play. Like, you know, don't ever worry about that side for me. I don't care. Like, if anything, I was telling you too. I was like, If no matter how you play, like everybody can think it's me, they're the reason that you're not hitting. I don't care, right? It doesn't matter, right? And I think that that's the biggest piece as well, is for coaches, if you're listening on the other side of this, great, Riley's doing all this and your player is doing all these things of not identifying with their performance, but you as a coach can't identify with their performance.
Yeah.
Right? Because their performance, a lot of times coaches and think it's their, like, is their performance. Right? Because, and again, like, yo, I'm like, I can't get on. I don't have the bat. I'm not standing in the box. And not only with that, even if I was standing in the box, my performance is not my identity. It's not your identity. Right? Like, and so at the end of the day, you know, this is just part of the journey, right? Like, I've had players that are all Americans. I've had players that have been trained some of the top hitters in the world. And I've also had guys that have had some of the worst seasons that I've ever played. Right? Like, and again, that's the part of coaching. And also too, as a player, like, you're gonna have amazing years and you're gonna have down years. And also too, some of those down years or some of those, you know, Murph and I had that conversation when I was there, was talking about, and we're gonna talk about this too, is like going into the SEC, right? I was like telling him, it's like, yo, like, you guys play somebody in the top 20 every weekend. Like, you don't get a break. Right. There's other leagues where it's like, OK, you know, we got a pretty tough matchup this week. But the next couple of weeks, the season's a little lighter. Or, you know, again, you guys the whole year, I think strength of schedule, you guys, when you guys finished, I think you were still like top 8 or 9 or something like that. Right. So you guys have a really tough schedule that you guys constantly play. But what it does is in those games, and you guys lost a lot of close games. Right.
Yeah.
But what I told when I was talking to Murph about, because even the Hall of Fame coach, right, could have this perspective of like, you know, at the time, like, you guys had lost a lot of close games. He's like, man, you know, he's always trying to get you guys better.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I was in the clubhouse with him, and he's like, he's like, man, I just, you know, I want these girls to be gritty, and I, you know, I want to, you know, I want them to fight for every pitch, and I want them to do these other things, right? And I'm like, well, the fact you're talking about it right now is like you're teaching them to do that, all that. And then the other thing is, you know, it's funny because I sent it to you too, was I sent him this cartoon, you know, clip that mm-hmm. it came across like yeah. on TikTok at the time. And it was talking about like how we have to go through hard things so that we're prepared for the battles that we're going to face. And so one of the mm-hmm. things I brought up to him is like, hey, like you guys have played in a lot of really close games against really tough opponents that when you guys get into regionals and supers and World Series, you've been facing these teams all year.
Yeah.
You've been playing close ball games all year. Yeah. And you know what? Yeah, you came up short in some of these games, but it's not like you guys were just getting demolished. Yeah. You're losing by one. You're losing by get some of these teams that are, again, you're facing somebody, you guys most of the time are facing somebody within the top 10, you know, in that little stretch that you guys were going through, right? And so you know, again, that was also a big piece. And then like again, seriously, like I ended up following him back. I sent him a message back when you guys ended up going to the World Series. It was just like, hey, like you guys had to beat Tennessee in the Supers, right? And I was there for the weekend. You guys lost the first two games to them, yeah. right? Which was yeah. big. And you guys snuck out that last win against them. But again, like those games prepared you, mm-hmm. You know, how to play in tight games and yeah. when the game mattered and all those things and, you know, how to manufacture one run yeah. if you needed one run rather than, you know, again, I don't think it benefits a lot of teams to be just winning every, you know, it doesn't benefit a lot of teams in the postseason if they just been 10 running everybody all year, right? Because you just don't know how to play in tight games. You don't, when the pressure's on, right? When you need to make this pitch, yeah. right? When you need this strikeout, when you need this double play, when you need this throw out to second base, when you need this hit, when you need this bunt down, when you like, if you're always playing ahead and never from behind and never trying to manufacture one, like all those things, when you get in the postseason, it becomes really difficult. Yeah. You yeah. literally have just never practiced it all year. And so, while on the same side of that, like you guys weren't the highest offensive team, your guys are facing some of the toughest pitching in the whole country. So again, when you went to the postseasons, it was very normal. And then also on top of that as well, you again, Murph does some crazy stuff. Some people don't agree with it. You know, again, even me and you talked about it in certain situations, right? That it's like, again, and it's part of his process. Like, yo, it'll be 2-0 and he'll be like, take.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. You're like, bro, I'm going to get a fastball right down the middle right now. Oh, take. Like,
yeah.
It's just, you know, and that's part of him manufacturing runs. And we talked about this too, is like younger athletes, right? Like even you as like a sophomore in certain situations, it's like a lot of times in certain situations, a player would be in it, like he knows them so well. He's like, they're probably going to overswing.
Yeah. Right.
And hit a ground ball right now and yeah. have a double play ball.
Yeah.
Or, you know, or something like that. So you can agree with it or not. But part of his strategy too is knowing his players so well for him to go, because he's known for, and you were this person multiple times for him, is he's known for pinch hitting for someone and them hitting a home run or coming up with a clutch hit or all these things, right? He does yeah. it all the time,
yeah.
right? So, but again, because he was saying is like, because he throws to you guys constantly in practice. So he mm-hmm. sees how you guys are hitting
yeah.
and he knows who's hot. He knows what's going on in your guys' lives. He knows it's like, okay, if I had a cut before the game, this situation comes up, I'm going to go to that player,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And so we talked about that a lot too, because there were certain situations, especially late in the season, where I'd be telling you, I'd be like, hey, I think Murph's going to do this in yeah. this situation if this happens. And then he would end up doing it, right?
Yeah.
And that's, you know, he would tap on your shoulder. I'd be like, hey, tomorrow I think you're going to DP. Like, yeah. I think, you know, again, you're hot right now. Like, this is the blah, blah. And yeah, and so we would have a lot of those conversations too. But I knew that, you know, a lot of those conversations were big too as well. And again, what I meant that for you, specifically for you and for coaching, is it's not that other places, like every coach wants the best out of you, right? But it's like how they get that. You want the best out of you, right? But I think the challenge also for coaching, just like it is for you, is figuring out like what is holding me back emotionally from my best performance. Yeah. Why can't I just play free?
Yeah.
Right? Why can't I just play like this is a wiffle ball game?
Yeah.
Why do I perform so well against? It's not like, oh, you know what? You're just not facing as good as pitching in those scrimmages. Or no. I'm facing the same pitchers.
Yeah.
Right? Like I'm facing this or, and you know, and again, not always, not in every situation. Yeah. Maybe some other arms are working, all the things. But, you know, with that, yo, they're better than this midweek pitcher I'm pitching again right now. Yeah. So like, what is the difference, right? And like, what's going on there, right? And so a lot of times, you know, again, we talk about like performance wise, there was a lot of conversations that you and I had about like really just unlocking you to be able to play free.
Yeah.
And trust and trust, you know, the work basically that, you know, that you had put in and with it. I know that this was a big combo. And so I think I wanted you to share this piece. Is you brought it up earlier, but you said the 10 swings, right?
Yeah.
And we talked about that obviously extensively towards the end of the year.
Yeah.
I wanted you to kind of talk about that and why, you know, what that was and what that meant to you.
Yeah, I don't remember when it was.
Probably like 3/4 of the way through the year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can vividly remember like where I was sitting, all the things, but I don't remember what series it was. But I was sitting in the hotel. I think it was when I got Benny, actually. Anyways, but I was sitting in the hotel lobby.
And, her puppy.
I was probably crying again. But we were talking, and I think it was also the time where I told you, I was like, I feel like I'm letting you down. Like, I'm letting down, like, the farm, like I represent something bigger than myself, my family, like my coaches.
She was also being very sweet. She was, what she typically does is, again, with it, like Bama's big on this too, right? Of like, you know, that you represent, like, you know, there's a culture. You also too are very aware of when people pour into you or like how much time they give you and effort. You said this multiple times about, you know, Murph and their staff and like all the things and all the resources and all the things, like you're very appreciative and like grateful. But also too, that turns into pressure for you. Now you feel like you need to perform and like to show that like it's worth it. Basically like you're worth their effort. And so you basically, again, the recap there, what she was saying was when she first came to me, she felt like, again, she knew all the conversation we had all the time. Like I had, you know, put into you all the time, farm, all the stuff. And, you know, she was like feeling all this pressure. And then go ahead.
Yeah. And so then we just kind of like talked through some things. And then you brought up the fact of like if you can just have the mentality of like count them down, like 10 swings, get 10 swings off and like get 10, like that's it. That's all it is. 10 swings and you're hitting 300, whatever the case is. And so I think that was so big for me because I'm also a very like if you tell me to do something like, or like write it something down, like I'm like a check, like I'm going to do it. Yeah. And so I think when it's like, okay, like 10 swings, okay, 9 swings. All right. 8 swings, 7 swings. And so like having that I feel like I started focusing on that instead of like the pressure of the game. And so I think when I'm like in the box, bases loaded in the first inning at Tennessee, like I'm not thinking about, oh my God,
situation.
Like,
it's
right. I'm thinking like, okay, I need 9 more swings. I need 8 more, like let's check off a box and get 1 more swing off.
Yeah.
However that can be. But then I also think when we first talked about that, I think it was, when I didn't get a swing, I'd get like frustrated almost instead of like thinking about it to where like it's 10 swings and how many, like I still have 4 weeks left in the season and I'm trying to get 10 swings. Mm-hmm. And I think I put so much pressure on myself to be like, okay, 10 swings, like ready, go. Like I got to get 10 swings and 10 at bats. Like,
that perfectionist side of you of being like,
yeah.
You, but to that, and again, not just you. And again, I want to point this out because I know, again, me included, but so many players out there that have this mentality where, again, you are so hard on yourself. First pitch, throws a pitch, you hit a foul ball, you swing and miss. And you're so frustrated with that first pitch that you gave up the rest of the bat.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And you're like, I should have hit that pitch. And then now the whole at bat is like over.
Yeah.
Right. So we, again, needed to develop a different mentality and a different way of like hunting. And so again, when I brought that up to you, basically the idea is like, hey, right now, if you finished with 5 more doubles and 5 home runs, more than you have right now. Like, man, you would have had, you crushed it. You destroyed the rest of the second half of the year, right? I'm like, think about it. That's 10 individual events. That's 10 moments in time. Those 10 swings don't matter if it's 0-2. Those 10 swings don't matter if you're up by 10, if you're down by 10. If you swung and missed the pitch before, you know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's the 14th inning. It doesn't matter if it's the first inning. It doesn't matter if it's the best pitcher in the league. It doesn't matter if it's the worst pitcher in the league. It doesn't matter any of the situations. It's 10 swings.
Right.
We're hunting 10 swings always. And again, it doesn't matter how ugly it looked. The other, you could have struck out four other at bats and you got your fifth at bat because you guys are in the fifth, you know, 14th inning. It doesn't matter. And you can get one of these swings off, right? Yeah. And so we're, and again, now within those 10 swings, you're going to get your singles. You're going to get some other things to pop up, but we're hunting, you know, these 10 swings that were doubles or home runs, right? And again, you can easily do, again, I try to tell you too, like, obviously, just how I know you can move, how I know you can perform, all those other things. And I share with you, again, along with it, because I've seen how you train. And again, like, yo, I've watched, I'm going to brag on her for a second. I've watched this girl hit like 9 home runs in a row. You know what I'm saying? I've watched you do crazy things, right? I've watched you do crazy things. So again, I understand where that frustration comes, where it's like, man, I'm struggling with this and why can't I do these other things? And a lot of that for you too was needing some of these emotional unlocks and also this pressure that like you were also, you know, putting on yourself. So again, that was like a strategy that we kind of came up with, which was at that time, that late in the year, it's like, yo, we're hunting these 10 swings, right? Yeah. And it doesn't matter the situation. It doesn't matter the time. And also too, you know, how silly it was that we were letting the pitch before or the day before or the same pitcher, you know, with it. And I think to your point, it showed up when you guys played Tennessee that last game, because those are two of the top pitchers that were, you know, in the league. They're both fighting for, you know, pitcher of the year.
Yeah.
And then also too, you guys saw them in the supers.
Yeah.
Right. And it's like, yo, like we talked about that. It's like mentality wise. I don't care, like, even if you would beat me, if you would beat me 99 out of 100 times, I'm trying to get you this time.
Yeah.
I'm going to get you this time. You're going to get 100% of my 80%. Like, I'm not giving up an extra out because I doubt myself. Like, I'm hunting you right now, trying to get this one of my 10 swings off, because again, my 10 swings don't care that Pickens is on the mound. I don't care if this is 76 or if it's 46. Like, I'm getting my 10 swings, right? And I'm always hunting my 10 swings, and if you slip and leave one over, Riley Valentine in super regional, let him have it, right? But I meant by that is, like, again, like early in the year, she had some dominant, you know, pitching performances against both those girls, against you guys. But in those games, in that moment, right? It's like, it could be the 14th inning and she leaves one over the middle, right? And you were hunting, right? And that was just a strategy, like, we kind of came up with to get you back, basically refocused.
And
then I kind of want to just wrap with this, and maybe you'll see, maybe we'll have I'm sure we'll have another combo. You're popping out later in the summer too, so I'm sure we'll do another pod, maybe you and Paige or something like that, where I get you guys together. But I'm going to give you this one, because I know you loved the little girls. What would you say to, you remember all the time, all the little 12-year-olds, everybody that's aspiring? I know there's a girl, you know, here today that you also got to spend some time with. And with it, like, what would be like your advice? Not so much about like recruiting or any of the things, but like, where should their focus be? Right. And what mentality would you share with them from things that you've learned from your experience over the years?
Yeah. I think that, you know, like growing up playing travel ball, like, it's, yes, you play for a team. Like, yes, you guys spend a lot of time together traveling, like all the things. But I think once you get to college, like, you're really a part of it. Like, you live with your teammates. You see your teammates every single day. Like, once you get into season and like postseason, like, you don't go a day without being with your team. And so I think that part is big. And I think building relationships is huge, because having those to fall back on in moments when you need it, whether it's like, okay, I need somebody to pour into me, or I need to pour into them, I think is obviously going to help them and the team have a better culture. But I think another thing is, for me, when I finally started just play free, was just like, keep the game of softball softball. Like, it doesn't change. It doesn't change when you're 12. It doesn't change when you're 18, 22. Like, yes, we're going to, the game is going to evolve and like people are going to get better, stronger, faster, all the things, but it's still the same game. And just keeping it fun and keeping it a game, I think, is the biggest thing. Like, whether it's a rally worm or a palm tree in the dugout, like whatever that looks like for you. And I think once I finally was able to like keep it a game and have fun with it, and I'm always dancing in the dugout and doing my thing, whatever, I think that's when I was finally able to just like go play, you know what I mean? And so like regionals, super regionals, World Series is when like I felt my best. And it's like, I'm like, I miss it so much. Like, I would do anything to be back in those moments right now, because I was having so much fun and taking in every moment. And not like softball, it wasn't fun in the beginning of the season when I was struggling. But not only was I struggling, but like, I wasn't having fun. And so I think once you bring it back to that, like, okay, I'm 0-3, but like, I can be of help to the team in another way, whether it's cheering, to doing this, picking up anything like that. And so I think that's the biggest thing, is just like, keep the game of softball softball. That's all it is. And just have fun. It doesn't matter at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. Softball's not who you are, it's what you do.
Yeah. It's called play for a reason.
Yeah.
Go play.
Yeah.
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 Cool. All right. Well, I always pray us out. So
okay.
Let's do it. All right. Dear Father God, I just thank you so much for our time that we got to spend together, God. We just ask that this podcast, and also to all the different ways that everybody listening find another way to find you and lean into you and deepen the relationships with you, God. Let them know that you can trust them, that they can trust you, and that you're a sturdy foundation, God. And just reveal yourself to them in your own ways, just like you have to me and Riley and Taylor and everybody else that's listening to this podcast, God. And just do your work, and just remind us that all things are for your glory, and that you can make all things work for good. And we pray all these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Well, until next time, Farm System out.